Shalisha Show, and today I'm going to be reading the book called Befriend by Scott Sails from Christ Presbyterian Church, and it's created belonging of age of judgment and isolation by Scott Sails and Anne Voskamp. So I'm going to be reading, it's basically about disabilities and special needs. So it says, befriend people with disability and special needs. One of the most memorable scenes from the movie Forrest Gump is when Forrest, Lieutenant Dan are spending the holiday together. In this scene, the lieutenant, who is confined to a wheelchair after getting both his legs blown off in the Vietnam War, expressing his truest feeling about God. Like many who suffered injuries, sickness, or loss, part of the Lieutenant Dan process of finding peace with God includes having an unstrained shouting match with God, with the unassuming Forrest as his audience. He ranks as following. At the VA, all they talked about is Jesus this and Jesus that. Have I found Jesus? They even had a priest come to talk to me. He said, God is listening. If I accept Jesus into my heart, I would get to walk beside him in the kingdom of heaven. Did you hear what I said? Walk beside him in the kingdom of heaven. God is listening. What a crook. So it was just explaining how his attitude was by being disabled. And everybody handles this disability differently. And what it was he had a generation of his forefathers died. And so he didn't accept Forrest Gump saving him. And, you know, and so, and that's how you kind of feel sometimes. And what this pastor is really saying is just making sure you respect people with different disabilities, because, you know, if it wasn't for YouTube, my disability that I have is totally different. Okay. Mine's just what I consistently on a job, what I can't do up here of what they expect. And see, that's the tough part, of my genes, my tough part from what my experience is, you know, from being fired. And I don't like what Morgan Freeman said about you guys can get on a bus. Well, some disability people can get on a bus. It doesn't bother them because nothing's up here is wrong. And with Lieutenant Dan, it wasn't nothing wrong with his brain. It was just something wrong with his legs and the fact that he wanted to die in a war like all his forefathers, and he didn't want to be saved. And so he was really mad at Forrest Gump and mad at God. But the thing was, God saved him because he wanted to break the curse of wanting to die in war. And some people do. They want to die in war. And you belong to Christ. And really, God doesn't even like war. If he didn't like Adam and Eve eating the wrong apple, of course he doesn't like war. Of course he says to love one another. Of course he said teach all nations. Okay, so I'm going to get back to the book. So I'm just thinking about Forrest Gump. What a great movie. Later in the movie, sometimes after he and Forrest had gone their separate ways, Lieutenant Dan showed up at the Forrest wedding in much more settled, restful state of mind. Forrest noticed this turning point and later observed he never actually said so, but I think he made his peace with God. Every time I watch Forrest Gump, I am most deeply moved when the injured lieutenant is shown to have found peace with God. I am moved because over the years, I've encountered many men, women, and children who lives have been a magnificent demonstration of kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and power of God, not in spite of their disability, but because of their disability. So even though I have a disability that may stop me or has stopped me from getting jobs and keeping jobs, with their expectation, I've never given up on God. I use YouTube as a therapy for me to keep going. Heroes in wheelchairs. According to the world-renowned grief expert Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, the most beautiful people are those who have known defeat, known suffering, known struggle, known loss, and have found their way out of depths. I remember Pastor Tim Keller saying something similar. The strongest souls are the ones that have emerged out of suffering. And the most massive characters are the ones that have been scarred, have been scared with scars. One such soul is Joni Erickson Tater, for more reasons than I am able to count. She has been a hero to Patty, me, for years. Joni, the founder of ministry for people with disability, is called Joni and Friends, has been paralyzed from the neck down since age 17 due to a diving accident. Joni has also battled stage 3 breast cancer, not unlike Lieutenant Dan. She has endured seasons of wrestling and sorrow and asking, why, Lord, why? Because of her disability illness, she has wrestled with a chronic affliction and has emerged, having also made her peace with God. So when God is keeping my mind from dying, I just remember doing Michael Jackson when I was saying, why? And Joni wrote the following reflections in response to the question that she, as a Christian, is asked often. If God is good, and if God has the power to do anything, why hasn't God healed you? To this she said, those steps following Jesus most often leads to a Christian, not to a miraculous divine intervention, but directly into the fellowship of suffering. In a way, I've been drawn closer to saviors, even with breast cancer. There are things about the characters that wasn't seen a year ago or even 6 months ago that tells me that I'm still growing and being transferred. When people ask about healing, I'm less interested in the physical and more interested in the healing of my heart. Pray that I get rid of the lazy attitude about God, word, and prayer, or brute pride. Set me free from the self-centeredness. Those are more important because Jesus thought they were more important. On her website, Joni summarized these same sentiments in the single sentence where she says, God will permit what he hates to accomplish that which he loves. How can she say something like that? I suspect that it has to do with her deep awareness of the cross of Jesus, where God permitted what he hates, the violent Marian death of his only begotten son, to accomplish what he loves, salvation for sinners whom he loved. Joni's acceptance to her physical affliction might trouble us until we are also given a window into her thoughts about a new heaven and a new earth, where, as the Bible says, there will be no more death, no more mourning or crying or pain. In the new heaven and the new earth, Jesus will make all things new, including frail, perishable, mortal, and sometimes disabled human bodies. Reflecting on her wheelchair, Joni said, I hope I can bring this wheelchair to heaven. I hope to bring it and put it in a little corner. Then in a new, perfect, glorified body, standing on the grateful, glorifying legs, I'll stand next to my Savior, and I will say, Jesus, do you see that wheelchair? You were right when you said that in the world we would have trouble, because that thing was a lot of trouble. But the weaker I was in this thing, the harder I leaned on you. And the harder I leaned on you, the stronger I discovered you to be. It never would have happened had you not given me the bruising of blessings of wheelchair. Then a real ticker tape parade of praise will begin, and all the earth will join in the party. So when wheelchairs become a pulpit, a friend of Joni named Lynn Wheeler, who is part of our church family here in Nashville, died just a few months ago. Lynn, like Joni, had been confined to a wheelchair for over a decade, paralyzed from the neck down due to a car accident. Before her accident, Lynn ran a marathon. She played, she had competitions, tennis, coach, swimming, and played the guitar. She was also a fully engaged church member. Friends, neighborhood, wives and mothers and grandmothers, while many would grow cynical and angry towards God after such harsh turns of event, Lynn dropped her anchor into God's promise. I can honestly say that Lynn Willard from her wheelchair was one of the most joyful, faith-filled, affirming, and other focused people I have ever met. Her resolve that God is good in every circumstance, coupled with her optimistic about the hope and future that God had prepared for her, led her to speak of disability not chiefly as affliction, but as her assignment. Lynn was determined that her disability would be an opportunity for God to receive glory in her thoughts. According to Lynn, loving and faithful husband Doug, when she woke up after being sedated for 7 weeks in the ICU and he told her about the accident, the first thought came to mind was verse from Psalms 139. All the days ordained for me were written in a book before one of them came to me. Verse 16, trusting in the faithfulness of God, she would later write, that's wonderful. My body is a mess right now, but is well with my soul. I know my days are ordained for me, and God will comfort and strengthen me when I am weak. I cling to his trust. I cling to his truth. Though it doesn't make sense, his plans for me continue. Though everything has changed, I take joy in the little things, find protection in my limitations. I think of heaven more. Lynn favored him, which became the central hymn at her funeral, just as it been the theme of the song of her life includes their lyrics. Whatsoever my God ordains is right. He is my friend, my father. He has suffered not to do me harm. Through many storms may gather now, I may know both joy, woe. Someday I shall see clearly that he has loved me dearly. Whatsoever my God ordains right, here shall my stand be taken. Through sorrow, needs, or death, he's mine. Yet I am not forsaken. My father care is round me there. He holds me that shall not fall, and so to him I leave all. A runner, a tennis player, a swimmer, a guitarist, a singer, a friend, a grandma, a mother, and a wife in a wheelchair for the rest of the days after a sudden accident took all away. And her conclusion to the matter was, I think of heaven more. Whatever my God ordained is right. It's no wonder that Lynn Willard's funeral, Pastor David Filson, declares that in her lifetime, her wheelchair became her pulpit. Joni Lynn and others who draw near to God through their disability give me hope for the day when my own mental emotions and physical decline arrives. They give me hope that when I'm hurting, God will be near, and that as my outer man wastes away, my inner man will be renewed and made strong. For just as Apostle Paul said about disability, that he referred to it as a thorn in the flesh. God's grace is significant. I can't say it. In every circumstance, and power is made perfect through our weakness. I have an accent or something going on. Indeed, we are fragile jars of clay. We do not lose heart because in comparison to the weight of glory that awaits us in a new heaven and the new earth, even our permanent afflictions are made temporary and the heaviest burden of lightened. So we're saying, God, why is some people afflicted? Because sometimes you can just go through family members and you'll see that most of them are disabled. So after I'm done, I'll probably go to sleep because I'm really tired, but. Excuse me. Thanks for the water, Lord. So, she's saying her wheelchair is her pulpit, and it really, really hurts me because we say, you know, women shouldn't be behind the pulpit. Well, that is hurtful. It's very hurtful for someone to say that, especially when God is coming to you with different assignments. So, a servant of God versus a pastor, a woman pastor, if that's for you or whatever, just keep teaching at home because this is not church. The throne of God is in heaven. And God is everywhere. So teach at home then. If they don't want you behind the pulpit, teach at home. Well, this is for people with disability. God bless you.